I wrote the first draft of Manmadhudu 2 and I came back to him and I pitched it to him. And he heard the whole thing and said, I really like it, but it's too classy, Rahul. You've got to make it more universal. I've treated Avantika the way she needs to be treated. I've put a camera there and let her be. I'm so glad that we're going to get to see Nag sir in a new age young film, because that's where he belongs.
Hi Rahul, welcome to Film Companion South.
Absolute pleasure, absolute pleasure.
So how does one go from a small in budget film like Chila Sau to this mega thing like Manmadhudu 2? I mean, first of all, the journey is incredible.
Right.
I mean, like, people don't get to this level for quite a time in their directorial careers, and you're doing it in the second film.
Right. I think it's a combination of factors. One, the fact that, you know, right place, right time. I happened to finish the film, and Samantha's been a best friend for a really long time now, and she was
You guys acted together in your first
film. In our first film.
Yeah.
So she said, listen, you've made this film and all, I'm very scared because if you haven't done a good job, you're going to lose out on your acting career as well as this one.
Right.
I know this is what you've always wanted to do, but show me the film. So very early on, once I'd finished my second cut, I went and showed her the film and she really liked it. And she's apparently gone and told Chai, he's made a good film, I really like it and all that. And Chai watched it and Chai then asked Nag sir to watch it. From there on, I wasn't in control of what was happening. Chai liked the film, he asked Nag sir to watch it. Nag sir watched it, he really liked the film. He said, you know what, let's release this, let's present the film. So then they tied up with my original producer. And the next thing you know, around a week and a half before the release of my film, Nag sir called me one day, said, come and meet me. And I was thinking it's something about the promotion strategy or whatever. And he said, there's this film, it's a film that I really like and I want you to watch it. And I think you'd be a good fit for it. Tell me if you'd like to make the film. And I said, sir, I don't understand. He said, with me. I said, oh, okay. And the first thing I asked him was, sir, I hope it's not a free make. He said, no, I don't believe in free makes either. That time is gone. We can't get away with all that now. So we've paid money, bought the rights. It's going to be an official remake. So watch the film. I watched it and I really liked what I could do with it. And honestly, I mean, it's a huge jump career-wise and there's no way I was going to say no to it. So an opportunity to direct Nag sir. And I said, yeah, I'm on board. And that's how this happened. And to answer that question from an industry point of view, what's also been happening, Nag sir has always had a track record of picking out guys with interesting ideas and a unique flavor and trusting them and giving them a film. He's had a track record of doing that. And some of his biggest successes, some of his most iconic films have going by that gut. And what is happening in the Telugu industry right now is that it's these content-driven, honest films that are working. Those are the films that are making, you know, they might not collect as much as another film, a bigger masala film, but in terms of return on investment, these films are really paying back. So the industry as such has been more receptive to picking up these directors who've, like for example, Gautam directed Malli Rava, which is again like Chila Sau, a very small film that was very well reviewed. And the next film he was doing with Nani and a bunch of other directors like us.
Right.
We've made a film, and if people have thought that, you know, there's some talent here, there's some craft here, they've picked up and given them bigger films, much bigger second films. So I think on one hand, it's Nag sir's philosophy that, you know, I'll go with my instinct and trust a new guy, coupled with, as such, what's been happening in the industry. So right place, right time.
So I was going to ask you this later, but I'm asking you this now because you brought it up. You know, all this Kerav Kancharapalam, all this Gudachari, all these kind of films that have been coming out and right back to Pelli Chupalo, whatever it is that started this whole thing. Is this a movement or is this just like every few months we get this odd film and it does this, what you call this return on investment kind of thing, and then, you know, nothing for a long time? Or do you think, see this as a steady movement?
In Telugu, for sure. I would like to say this sort of started with Swami Rava. Swami Rara was probably the first new age film to come out and make money at the box office and, you know, give the producers and distributors a return on investment. And then came Pelli Chuplu, like you said, there was Arjun Reddy, and a bunch of other films came and phenomenal return on investment. And I think it's here to stay, for sure. Typically, if you look at any industry, it's a cycle usually, right? So suddenly you'll have a bunch of content-driven films coming out and people are tired of masala content and they start flocking to these films because it's offering them something different.
Right.
They start making money, and after a point of time, you have too many of this, right? And the bar's been set very high by maybe one or two films, and then the others, even though they're actually good films, aren't able to match the bar. So contextually speaking, they're not suddenly doing as well as they should have. and then you return to the masala cycle. I mean, everybody wants both, right? So I think right now we're in a cycle where probably for the next 4 or 5 years, it's looking solid that new age content is going to do well at the box office. There is going to be a big tentpole films that exist side by side. Those are the films that make the big monies, which in turn help us make our smaller films, right? So that's always going to coexist. But right now, this seems to be the flavor of the decade, if I can say. But that cycle will change again. At one point, I'm sure one Hindustani, your Baradwaj type masala movie will come and set the box office on fire, and then suddenly everybody will... So it's a cycle. I think right now we're in this phase cycle, of the cycle.
But it's curious you mentioned Arjun Reddy in that cycle, because I saw it as kind of being a little different from the other ones, because first of all, it's very, very hero-centric. And the second thing is it also plays on a certain Devdas template, which is not really unfamiliar. I mean, of course, it does it in a very fresh manner.
Right.
But I would say, like those movies, that Pelli Chuplu type movies, those are actually much more, for a Telugu,
personal.
They were like personal pieces. This is also personal in a way. But having said that, what do you really feel about Arjun Reddy?
First part of the question, I'm talking about a broader context.
Right.
So, in a broader context, it is a new age way of storytelling.
Okay,
right?
Okay.
There aren't your typical masala elements where you're saying, oh, wait, we've gone 15 minutes into the screenplay without comedy, so let's insert comedy.
Right.
We've gone 20 minutes without a song, let's put in
so
a song.
It's not that format.
It is a very new age way of telling a story.
Yeah.
And I don't know if this is a good idea, but I personally, I've had this conversation at home as well. And I liked the film. I liked Arjun Reddy when I watched it. I saw a lot of craft in it. The sound design blew my mind. Phenomenal, I thought. I walked out of that film half in doubt if they'd done sync sound, and I later heard they hadn't, and the sound design was phenomenal. There's a lot of craft in the film.
Right.
And barring one or two scenes that I felt a little uncomfortable, you know, I squirmed a little bit, I thought most of the film maintained a reasonably neutral perspective. And incidentally, I remember meeting Sandeep once after the release, and we had a chat about it. And he said, when I set out to make this film, I wasn't making it with a star. Even Pelli Chuplu hadn't happened when I made that film.
Right.
So I wasn't making the film with a star, and I wasn't trying to make this character iconic or anything. I was just trying to tell a story as honestly as I could.
Right.
And I buy that. I thought it had a neutral perspective. I don't have a problem with the film. And just to set the record straight, my wife hasn't even seen the film. She doesn't have a problem with the film.
Okay.
She likes her Disney kind of films, where happy beginning, happy middle, happy ending,
right,
sort of films. So she hasn't even watched the film. Her issue wasn't with the film, just to set the record straight.
I wasn't going there at all.
So no, I liked Arjun Reddy for sure. I liked Arjun Reddy, and not just Arjun Reddy, all these new age films that have come about. That also, my first film, incidentally, I pitched it to someone about 4.5 years back, a star. And they heard it and said, I really like it, but I'm not sure I can do this.
Yeah.
I won't get away with it, for the simple reason that tomorrow it will be sold to my distributors at the rates at which my usual films are sold. And I don't think it can make that kind of money back.
Okay.
That being the case, I'll be in soup. So I can't make this even if I want to. And he was spot on. I had to agree with him. Luckily for me, after that, a Pelli Chuplu happened and a bunch of these films happened. And suddenly, everybody took notice and said, you know what? Maybe these films will make money.
Okay.
So mine didn't go really big or anything. It was a well-reviewed film that made its money back and a little bit of a decent profit. It didn't go big as some of these other films. But I'm just saying that that's been the trend. So yeah.
So we're talking about sensibility here. How easy is it to... You said you're remaking a film. What film is it?
It's a French film. I don't want to name it right now because you don't want people going up and looking up the synopsis.
Okay.
Because it's not a faithful remake.
Okay.
It's a screenplay that's been written from scratch. So I don't want people going and reading the story. So let's not take the name of the film, but it's a French film.
Right. So you have this French film, and you're moving to it from Chilasau.
Right.
And now you're in... I'm going to generalize a bit, stereotype a bit, because there is a certain thing that a big star movie, there are certain check boxes in a big star movie that need to be ticked off, that you probably don't have to in a small film, simply because the expectations are literally nothing. It's people are either going to buy the film or not the film.
Right.
But here they're going to not just buy the film, but they need to like the character of the star and what the star is doing and the star's past history and things like that. Let me just ask you this first yes or no question. Do you think you have retained the sensibility that you had in Chilasau in this bigger, big star movie?
Yes and no. It might sound cliche, but I'm really, really glad I had someone like Nag sir to sort of handhold me through the process. He's a very new age man who's become a star doing old school cinema. He understands both of it, and he understands it very well, very intuitively. So he sort of, I remember I wrote the first draft of Manmadhudu 2, and I came back to him and I pitched it to him. And he heard the whole thing and said, I really like it, but it's too classy, Rahul. You've got to make it more universal. And I didn't quite get what he was saying. And he said, remember this, do not, it's okay making a classy film, but do not intellectualize emotions. When you're dealing with emotions, make them very, very simple, clear. Sometimes it's okay to spoon feed so that everybody gets it. How you want to spoon feed, you figure out. I'll leave it to you. You retain your sensibilities there, but I want you to spoon feed it. There are moments in this film where you're going to have to say what a character is thinking. I can't have silences in a certain way an actor looks at another actor and RR giving a very subtle cue for the audience as to what to feel. I think there was a, because of that, because he was able to handhold me through the process, because he has worked with new age directors before who have the sensibility, he understands the problem we face. I approached it saying, what are they talking about? Where is the issue here? And then I slowly understood. And it was a very, very steep learning curve, right? When I made my first film, that story had been gestating in my head for almost 10 years, right? I had originally thought of that story in my head 10 years back. And by the time I actually sat down to write the screenplay for Chila Sao, I had seen that film shot by shot in my head at least 5,000 times, shot by shot. So I literally finished my first draft in 4 or 5 days, and I did my second draft in another 4 or 5 days. In less than 2 weeks, I was done with my final draft of the script. Because I had visualized it, I was just writing down what I was already watching in my head.
Right.
On one hand, this wasn't my own story, right? I was taking someone else's story and adapting it. That itself, you know, started the process off on a very different note. And I hadn't seen that film so many times in my head. So when I put pen down to paper, I was sort of exploring. I didn't have a visual map in my head where I knew I was going in this direction. And on the other hand, by the time I was writing my fourth or my fifth draft, Nagsar would say, okay, this point of the screenplay here, it needs a new character coming in. You need to. And I'd be like, how can I just randomly get someone in? And then he'd say, this part needs humor. And the good thing about him is, he'd be very patient. He'd say this. I had made up my mind that, listen, this man has 35 years of experience to draw from. He's made good films, great films, bad films, and he's learned from all of them. Trust him blindly when he says, I want a change.
Right.
And on his part, he said, I want this change. How you want to make this change, I'll leave it to you. You go figure it out, break your head, take your own time, take 2 weeks, 3 weeks, but I want the change. How you do it, I'll leave it to you. So in that sense, by the time I was doing the fourth or the fifth draft, and I never thought I was a person with ego, and I realized I did have an ego. I realized somewhere in Chila Sao, I didn't need to, and I never separated the film from the filmmaker. Yeah, yeah. To me, the film and me were one, right? Without me realizing it. So when it came to this film, by the time it was the fourth or the fifth draft, I said, hang on a second, it doesn't matter what you think. It doesn't matter how you think you should write a screenplay. The film matters more than you. Look at the film in isolation, understand what the film needs, and do something you wouldn't do. That might go against your natural grain, but you have to do it. And somewhere, I think that's when, initially I was being forced to do it, because Nagsar wanted to change, like, oh, okay, I have to make this change, how do I do this and all that. But after a point, I started enjoying that process. It sort of became liberating at one point when I said, you know what, your film's not the same as you.
Right.
Your film's not a reflection of who you are. Who the hell do you think you are? You've made one film. So put that aside, shut your ego down, even if it's very minimal, and make the film that needs to be made. And that's when I started sort of saying, okay, you know what, maybe the film can go in this direction, why not? And it became a more explorative process than my first film. Even when I went and made the film, forget the screenwriting, even when I went and made it, I did not stop until I got exactly how I'd seen it in my head. I made shot by shot, frame by frame, exactly the way I'd seen it in my head. This film, not just the screenwriting process, when I went to the set, I had a very experienced veteran cast, phenomenal actors, right? And at some points, I started realizing, you know what? You let them go. When they start flying with it, they take you to very interesting places.
Right.
Let them go. Because of which I had to start becoming doubly aware of the overall graph, the overall arc, and making sure they're not taking the film in a completely different direction. Then you just go pull them back. But with this film, all I had to do was just prod and push in the direction I wanted to go in, and they were flying with it. And in that sense, it was a very liberating process that, okay, if you sit back and let it take a shape of its own, and just make sure it's not going out of the paradigm that you've set for the film, you can get so many interesting things. And it's in that sense, I think, was the biggest difference. It was more explorative making this film and writing this film. Although it's a very light-hearted, very flaky film, and yet I learned a lot more.
So would you say that, because the one of the very definitions of a director, which we don't follow, there are two definitions of director, right? One that is an auteur in a sense who kind of does his film. The other one is basically a traffic cop who basically signals and says,
correct,
you know, you go this way, you go
director
this way.
Director filmmaker.
Director filmmaker. So it's basically just shepherding the various stages of. So are you saying you have it in you to be the auteur as well as the traffic cop? Is that what you're saying?
I think so. Good question. I need to sit and think about what you've just asked me. But I think so. This film that's... See, eventually, what you wanted to make, your sensibilities, your style, will come through. You don't have to feel...
Yeah.
If you can let go a little, it'll come through and it'll get better. Right? People take it... You work with people you trust.
No, but the better word is something... I'm just quibbling now because I want to get at the heart of this process. Now, Rahul Ravindran wanted to make a movie, which was the first draft, but Nagarjuna, being the star, knew the commercial space and said, okay, I'm going to take this movie that Rahul Ravindran wanted to make and I'm going to make it the movie that my fans will probably appreciate more.
Oh.
So doesn't that very much become now the movie that Rahul Ravindran initially did not want to make?
No, not at all.
Okay.
Like I said, it was sort of an evolution. Really.
Okay.
The script evolved from being this to that. That's the good thing about Nag sir. One, he understood what kind of film we were making.
Right.
He had a very clear understanding of, this is what I asked Rahul to make. This can't become, like for example, Amas or some of his biggest hits were commercial, proper commercial pot boilers. He had a very clear understanding of the fact that it can't go there.
So within the Rahul universe, it...
Not within the Rahul. For us, after a point, for both of us, it became the film.
Okay.
I don't matter, he doesn't matter, it's the film that matters. This is what we set out to make.
No, but film is always an entity. It's not an entity, it's an entity that's shaped by someone, right? So
yeah.
I'm just asking, the shaping, is that something you're okay not having too much control over as a filmmaker?
No, so that was the second part of my answer. Yeah. So on one hand, he understood that the film needed to operate within a certain paradigm.
Right.
That it can't go beyond that. He had a very clear understanding of that. That helped. Number two, he never asked for changes from his image point of view or anything like that. His changes were purely from the story point of view. He had a very sound understanding of the story we were trying to make.
Right.
And number three, the most crucial factor is, every time he asked me for a change, he let me go figure it out myself.
Right.
Right? He did not say, make this change this way.
Okay.
He would say, this is the change I want. Like, bring in a new character here. And then he'd leave it open to me.
Right.
Whatever kind of character I wanted to bring in, what I wanted that character to do, he left it to me. He let me, and he gave me time. He wasn't breathing down my neck. He gave me his own time. So somewhere, I was able to figure out solutions to the things that he wanted.
Right.
So I think it was a very symbiotic process.
Way.
Yeah, it was very organic that way. And what was my way, I'm just a beginner. I've made one film and this is my second film. What was my way started becoming more flexible. And which is why I think working with Nag sir has helped me understand or expand my horizons in terms of how I conceive a scene or what the next scene can be. Like, for example, when I was doing my first film, it was always what the character needed to do.
Right.
I never thought beyond that. I never thought beyond audience might want something here, they might want something, nothing. I was like, no, my character from this point to this point, at this point, he can't do comedy. It's as simple as that. I'm not going to do comedy. Whereas Nag sir said, at this point, you need a little bit of humor in the film. So then he let me figure out, okay, this character's in this situation, without losing the integrity of that graph, how do I put him in a funny situation and generate humor?
Okay.
Right? So it was a very symbiotic, healthy process that way. And I think, which is why for a newcomer, almost a newcomer like me, if he had to work with a star for the first time in his career, Nag sir is a fantastic choice. He'll understand, he'll handhold, and yet he'll never put a leash on you. He'll just handhold very gently and take you there, where he wants to get. So that sense, it was a very liberating process. And I think it's helped me. Tomorrow, when I made Sheela Sao and I went and watched that film in a theater for the first time, I learned a lot. It was like, whoa, oh, okay. Because when you sense that they like a scene, there's no better high than that. And when you sense that they're getting restless in a scene, like, okay, why was I so stuck up on that? They're getting restless. That helped a little bit, but with this film, that learning curve became much steeper. Like, so in this it became, stop thinking that your character needs to do this next. Start thinking that your film needs this next. So within that, how do I make my character organically do this?
Right.
So yeah, it was good fun. It was good fun that way.
How much of Nagarjuna's screen presence were you able to play around with, given that all that you've said? And from the trailer, there's this thing that's evident, the teaser, it's evident that it's a much older man and a younger woman. You know, typically people in our movies, our heroes, don't like to be portrayed as older. You know, in earlier generations, for generations, they kept acting with younger heroines and younger heroines because they just wanted to, like, maintain. Whereas here's a film where it's actually saying that the hero's older.
Yep.
So what was that like? I mean, how much have you been able to play around with?
I think it's to do with Nag sir and how open-minded he is. In fact, even before I had thought of how to pull this off, the first thing he called me and told me was, he said, Rahul, at this age, I'm attempting to do a film like this, right? I don't want to become a joke, there is no way he will, because he pulls it off. When I was writing some of the lines, I was like, he doesn't even look that old. Why am I writing this line? However, he said, before anybody gets to make fun of me, let's make fun of me in the film, brutally. I said, sir, but why? He said, sir, but fans, and I said, I am not worried. Why are you worried about my fans? Let's tell people for what it is. Because people, when they're watching the film, that's what they're going to be thinking.
Right.
Might as well address it, no? Put it out there in the open and say, yep, this is what it is. I am an older man in the film, and there is a much younger girl in the film. And it is a story about two such people. What happens between them? Is it a romance? Is it not? You'll find out when you watch the film.
Right.
But, which is why the first teaser, he said, cut it that way. You've put these dialogues in the film, cut it that way. Be brutal. Let's start the promotions of Manmadhudu 2 on this note where everybody in the film is making fun of me. And then we say what this guy really is. So I think it's got to do more with the drive he had. He was very clear that let's not skirt around the issue. Let's not BS people. Let's tell people what it is. So yeah, I think it came from him. Really. And trust me, Nag sir is a man that is about 25, 30 years younger than you and me mentally. The kind of music that he listens to, how much he's in tune with the fashion of today, for example. He's very experimental with his clothes. He's very flamboyant with his clothes. And he keeps scolding me, saying, Rahul, you have very outdated taste in music, man. I'm much more modern than you are. And he actually is.
Like what? What does he listen to?
Oh, trust me, he's tapping into Latino music, for example, is the current race, like Despacito and all that, and those kind of songs. And he's tapping into that. He knows why it's working. He thoroughly enjoys it. And he's got this, I have, for example, I think since the noughties, I haven't really followed the music scene. I go back to what music I like and my music sort of stopped there.
Right.
That's not the case with him. He's always sampling these. He's a man who went to Woodstock, by the way. He was at Woodstock. And I heard this and I was like, wow, I'm making a movie with a man who went to Woodstock. I'm just in awe of how cool this man is.
Right.
And he's way cooler. He's how he handles social media, for example.
Which Woodstock?
The Woodstock, man. He was at Woodstock.
Okay.
And today, he listens to Despacito and he digs that as much as he used to dig Jimi Hendrix. And that's how cool a man he is. And I'm constantly in awe of how much younger he keeps getting by the day. And that is what I think sort of reflects in how you look is often half to do with the vibe you give out, right? You give out a certain vibe, you automatically start looking younger. And the reason everybody says, wow, he's evergreen, he looks young, it's because of that. That man and his vibe is so young, it's scary for me. Like, he gives me a complex. I remember Chinnu came to shoot one day, she looked at him and said, and then she looked at me and my newly formed tummy and how out of shape. I'm like, she just said this. She looked at me and said, shame on you. Look at him. And she went off. I'm like, ah. And that's how young he is mentally. So I think all that sort of comes through in how he understands what this film needs to be. He probably understands it better than I do. So I think I'm so glad. Forget the fact that I'm a part of this film. I'm so glad that we're going to get to see Nag sir in a new age young film. Because that's where he belongs. That's where his grain is. That's where he truly belongs. That's his natural habitat. So I think that's one of the biggest, most exciting things about Manmadhudu 2 for me. When I think audiences go and watch it tomorrow, when his younger fans go and watch it tomorrow, they're like, ha, you know, that works. This rhythm, his mannerisms in the film, his character in the film, that just clicks. And it clicks at his age because he's that young. So, yes. Up there.
So, the teaser 2,
right.
The Avantika teaser, right. With the Rakul Preet Singh role. Now, that character has drawn a fair amount of attention online. For a bunch of reasons. One is, of course, you know, with your wife's tweets and all that, they've taken some of it in the wrong context or whatever. But what I want to ask is, I'm going to read out a line from your blog.
Okay.
From
my blog? Which one?
Yes.
Okay.
So this January, you wrote a blog entry titled The Gender Politics of Culture.
Right.
And you said, don't assume that a woman dresses a certain way only to grab our attention.
Right.
The universe doesn't revolve only around us. But even if she dresses that way for it, sure, give her attention, look all you want, but don't be creepy about it. Right. Now, this is a fairly evolved way to, you know, address that whole thing where you're saying we're all sexual beings, but there is a certain way we can do that without being creepy or invasive or all that.
Right.
But the very nature of putting a heroine in costumes that are, I'm not saying necessarily objectifying, but that are glamorous, or what would loosely be called glamorous or sexy or whatever it is,
right.
Isn't that kind of enabling people to do what you're advising against in your blog?
What am I advising them against?
No, as in
I'm
like...
What I am saying in my blog is that how a woman dresses up has nothing to do with us. I know some of my guy friends who 20 days to the gym and there's one small curve here, they start wearing sleevelesses. Does that mean they become what we call women who dress that way?
Right.
Right? The S word. So my point was that let's not make up the rules for how we want them to dress up. Let them decide how they want to dress up, just like we get to do it.
Right.
I get to walk around in my shorts whenever I want without being judged for it.
Right.
Let them do it their way. And if you think somebody is attractive, look all you want. Just don't be invasive, like you said, and creepy about it. And if you notice, I'd like to think the difference in my film is that I've set my film in a world where it's natural for that girl to be wearing clothes like that.
Okay.
If you see the film, it's not for the sake of milking glamour or anything like that.
Right.
It's very, very natural for that girl to be dressed up that way in the world that I've created in the film, number one. Number two, even the few shots in the teaser, you'll notice that there is no inherent male gaze in it. But I'm not zooming in on any portion and saying, when I show you a girl who's dressed this way,
right,
this is where you look. That's not what I'm saying. I put a mid on her and she's walking and you look where you want to.
Right.
You think she's very attractive, look where you want to, but don't be creepy about it. That's all I'm saying. Now, when you watch a woman in front of you, in person, like that, I'm saying don't make them uncomfortable, man. You get to dress the way you want, let them dress the way they want. That's all there was to it, that line. So,
right. No, I understand
see how
that.
It's enabling them to do...
No. What I'm saying is, now you're putting that with that intention and your blog is saying the right thing, but I'm saying that the fact that this is happening on screen and the fact that this is not something you intended is going to make a million people like young put up posters on the walls or do this or do that or whatever it is. You don't see that as a contradiction?
No, I don't.
Okay.
What's wrong?
I'm just curious how you see it. So yeah.
Because
when you're working on a film and you're working on a big glamorous film and foreign locations and people dress in all kinds of exotic dresses and things like that, you're saying that I'm completely okay with that because that's the world of the film, and if people are kind of taking away something wrong from it, then it's their problem. Is that what you're saying?
First of all, it's a very subjective thing. But let's say there is this, what people call an attractive, good-looking girl who suddenly walks into this room. And let us say she's dressed in a certain way, which is not head to toe. Now, how would you react to her? How would you react to her, right? You're not going to make her uncomfortable by staring at the wrong places, would you?
No.
Would you and I? No, I'm saying that's the right thing to do. And I've shot my film exactly the same way.
Okay.
There is a girl who's dressed a certain way, walks into the film. Now, as a filmmaker, I'm not looking at her a certain way, where I'm subscribing or I'm endorsing a male gaze. I'm looking at her as she is, right? Now, if that makes you uncomfortable, we should look into ourselves and say, why is it making me uncomfortable? I get to dress up the way I want. Let her dress up the way I want. I can. For example, I find some women incredibly hot, to use the right word. And there are YouTube videos where I have a huge crush on certain women. If they're looking really hot in a YouTube video, I watch that video. I don't have a problem with it. But tomorrow, if I meet them in person and they're dressed exactly the same way as they are in that video, I'm not going to behave in a certain way that I make them uncomfortable.
Okay.
It's their choice. It's their prerogative to dress the way they want. Because in this world, I get to dress the way I want. Right? I sometimes come to my dubbing studio dressed in shorts because I've spent the night here in the studio. Right? So it's up to them. That's all I'm saying. And in my film, for example, there is a certain honesty. I made Sheela Sir, and I had my heroine dressed from head to toe throughout the film. The whole film happens in a night. She comes from a certain background. Those clothes felt like the right kind of clothes for that character.
Right.
The kind of clothes that Rakul wears in this film is very organic to the world that she inhabits and the kind of character that she is. Now, I haven't zoomed in anywhere, done nothing. I'm saying this is the girl that she is. Now, how do you look at her is something subjective and I have no control over. However, what I do have a control over is, as a filmmaker, how I gaze at her.
Right.
And I am supremely confident there is nothing wrong with the gaze that I've employed in the film. Every time the camera looks at Avantika, there is no inherent male gaze. So, yeah.
So the whole reason I set this up for you and got this explanation from you is to kind of imagine myself as a Twitter troller.
Okay.
after the film comes out and see what you might have to say about these things. So I think you answered that pretty well.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You gave me a platform to do that. Preempted.
Because I was just thinking, okay, this is what they're going to say. So how is Rahul going to handle it? So yeah, I think you kind of...
I think if people read that particular blog, and it was very heartwarming, some of the responses I got to that blog. I had a bunch of guys saying, you know, I always used to think that way, that why would they dress up like that? It's only for cheap attention, no? And I read your blog and I realized, yeah, hang on a second. Why don't I ever ask myself that question every time I go out in shorts or sometimes with my three buttons open? A girl leaves three buttons open, whoa.
Yeah.
You see it very differently. I walk out with two buttons open all the time and I never get judged for it.
Right.
That's all I've said in that blog. And my film's exactly the same. I mean, I've treated Avantika the way she needs to be treated. I've put a camera there and let her be. That's what I've done. So
Chila Sao, Manmadhudu 2.
Right.
Now, are you saying you're comfortable going both ways, or is the trajectory of a typical director going to be like, now that I've gone to this kind of a movie, it's going to be difficult for me to scale back to the small personal movie that I want to make? Because the thing is, commercially speaking, this might be a better thing for you because everybody wants to be known. They want bigger market for their films. They want bigger stars in their films, which guarantees bigger reach.
And you financially settle down faster.
Yeah. So as opposed to, like, I've got this crazy little idea, this whack out thing that nobody's going to, you know, do except small, like with a small budget. And do you think you're going to be able to, or put simply, does greed corrupt? Is that kind of a...
There is absolutely no doubt that greed corrupts. There is no doubt about that. But I think somewhere you have to realize, I quit my job and came back to try cinema for a reason. I bided my time. I waited till I got an opportunity to make my film. Until then, acting was fun. I liked doing it. I still do. But that's not what I wanted to do with my life. My end game was always this, which is why sometimes I was okay getting into bad films, knowing I was getting into a bad film, because I'd wait 10 months and I wouldn't get a script I liked.
Right.
And I said, okay, I have bills to pay, so let's go do this film and hope that the director does a better job of it than he narrated to me. I shut up and do my job and get out. Because I always knew it's okay. If you do a bad film, it's okay. Even if you offers dry up, it's okay, because your end game is this. Now, having gotten here, there is huge pressure. Like, I typically get people saying, now next film's got to be bigger. Otherwise, people think, they're like, why is he doing a smaller film? And this, I get this all the time. I think I need to understand when to play what card. I think right now is an age, I'm at a stage in my career where I probably should look at building up a certain profile, hopefully. Hopefully, the films I do well, and I'll build up a certain audience for me who will probably at some point get interested in, okay, if this guy's making something, I'd be interested in going and watching it. Hopefully, I can get there someday. And if I get there, maybe then I'll have a chance to say, okay, enough. I've done whatever I do. I mean, I've done as per what advice you've given me. I need to go do the films that I want to do now. Hopefully, at some point. I don't know when that point will be. But I have about 8-9 scripts ready. And there is no clear progression there in terms of the kind of content there is, in terms of the kind of budget. One's like a really small film, and then I also have a script which is like an 80 crore fantasy film. So there's this, there's that. Now I just need to figure out what to do next, which is also hopefully somewhere in the same plot line as what the others want me to do. So we'll figure that out. But yeah, at some point I definitely want to go make those small films that I have as well. Hopefully when I build an audience for myself, I think that will happen. Yeah.
Hopefully. So.
Although this film has helped me understand how to not just look at a film in terms of the plot and the characters, but go beyond that and say, put elements that people get excited by, that people come to a theater to watch, that gives them a high. It's like, I'm a Rahul Dravid fan, but I know people go pay money for Sachin, not for Dravid, right? They don't want to see Dravid block the ball first day of a test match in the first session. They want to see Sachin hit sixers. And I've sort of, I think, begun to understand that a little better thanks to Nag sir and the things that I've sort of learnt from him. But you need to... Like, I remember I cut Avantika's teaser. It was a very classy, very sweet teaser. He came and said, Rahul, you said you want to... You know, we need to cut a teaser for her. I completely agree. She's got an important role in the film. We need to cut a separate teaser for her. Why have you cut such a bland teaser for her? You cut such an interesting teaser for me. Cut something interesting for her. I said, okay. And those sort of things in the screenplay writing as well, in when making the film as well. So hopefully even the smaller films I will make tomorrow will have a few more factors that will interest the audience in terms of wanting to come and watch it on a big screen. So we'll see.
All the best.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi guys, if you liked this interview and all the lovely, wonderful interviews that Baradwaj Rangan and his team does, please do not forget to like, share and subscribe to Film Companion South.